Welcome to Sartor TV. I'm Jennifer Crumpton. Today I'm talking with Deborah Quazzo, founder and managing partner of GSV Advisors in Chicago. Welcome, Deborah. Thanks so much for being with us.
Absolutely. Thrilled to be here.
You have a fascinating career background. Can you tell us a little bit about your career journey and what you think has made you so successful in that journey?
Well, it's probably a little early to call whether I'm so successful in that journey, but absolutely. I started pretty traditionally out of college and business school, working in the finance sector. Worked for Merrill Lynch for actually 13 years. Covered a lot of big companies and big sector coverage. And somewhere along the line, I it's better to be lucky than good very often. I fell into covering some highly entrepreneurial companies. Started and run by founders who had found a great idea and been able to capitalize on it and ended up taking a number of those founders and their companies public. And I realized at the time I'm the child of an entrepreneur, actually an entrepreneur many times over, my dad. And I realized that I was completely energized by being around entrepreneurs and I love companies of all sorts and particularly growth companies. And so I realized at that point that I was a lot more interested in sort of focusing on people who were creating things and rather than focusing on the bigger companies. So that really led me into ultimately led me into the education space. I began to focus broadly on people doing innovation in various technologies, but clearly education innovation resonated for me. I think I can give my parents some credit for that. They've been very active, not in the professional, but in the civic side of education. And I began working with a partner, Michael Moe, who is based in Silicon Valley, who joined me at Merrill Lynch in 2000. Something, I'll forget the exact year, but anyway, who had done a lot of seminal research, Wall Street research, really around the education sector, and really had made a big thesis that education would become, one of the next big investment categories back in the, he proposed that thesis back in the 1990s, actually, he joined Merrill Lynch in the late 1990s. And it became clear to me that as I worked more and more in the entrepreneur space with education entrepreneurs, that the impact that those entrepreneurs could have on learning outcomes and on learners and on providing greater access for more people to the future was something that really excited me. So I really have, with every step of my career, I've concentrated more on that side of the business. Ultimately, we started a company called Think Equity Partners, sold that business in 2007, left to start GSV in 2008. And when I started GSV, my part of it is the advisory business. I decided that in my old age, I really wanted to hunker down and focus on the thing that made me most passionate. So we focused solely on working with education innovators, heavy bias towards technology, but not always technology, but a lot of technology, and working with those entrepreneurs around raising capital and doing strategic advisory work. So that is that's kind of what has led me to where I am today. That ultimately led me to making quite a number of angel investments in the education technology sector, which has been another great sort of turn in my career. In terms of just being incredibly satisfying and nothing more fun than watching a successful entrepreneur drive a big idea.
You started in 2008 GSV. How what was that like? It was a stellar year.
Well, actually, we actually started Think Equity Partners in 2001, which was even worse. So it was a full service investment bank. We had stock trading and we had research and we had investment banking, and we started in June of 2001 thinking that we'd hit the absolute bottom of the market, and needless to say, we had not hit the bottom of the market. You probably would not come to me for market prognostication, but that was actually trial by fire. Obviously, we had the deeply depressing circumstance of 9/11, which created even more economic pressure on a young business, not to mention the emotional pressure. So we had, having gone through the prior experience, I think starting GSV in 2008 actually seemed like a cakewalk. And at the time, while the global economy was melting down, interestingly, the education technology sector, which had been really dead since the crash in 2001, and where there had been really little to no investment in the sector from the venture or growth equity communities, it had in 2008 actually began to turn, and for the first time from the from really zero. And so, strangely enough, I think 2008 was actually a very fortuitous year to begin a practice that was going to focus on education innovation and education technology, because it really was the year that marked the upswing in that sector, as opposed to the downswing that was being seen in many, many other sectors. So it actually was just fine to be doing that in 2008, a little tougher in 2001.
What role have mentors played in your career, and who have been some of your mentors? You mentioned your parents earlier.
Yeah, well, for sure. My parents are just extraordinary mentors, and it was great to grow up with a serial entrepreneur, and my dad. My mother is an extraordinary leader and civic leader, and beautiful speaker and everything else. So I had two really great models to work from. I was talking about this earlier today. I had a great mentor growing up who was actually became the publisher of the paper, who inspired me to go where I wanted. Helped me decide in my own mind when I was 12 or something where I wanted to go to college. Unfortunately, that worked out. And then at Merrill Lynch, I actually had an extraordinary mentor, because that's a big company. It's an industry that's not if it, even today, but certainly at the time, was not an industry that there were a lot of women. And I had an extraordinary mentor and a guy named Dan Bailey, who was here in Chicago and then New York, who really helped me take a risk in starting a business within Merrill Lynch, which was pretty unorthodox. That really was the landing pad for me to take off and become more engaged in the businesses that I started subsequently. So I really do credit a couple of very specific people for kind of giving me the liftoff that that I needed to do the rest.
So you were an entrepreneur first.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, which was a pretty rare thing at Merrill Lynch in those days. So it was really extraordinary to have somebody who let me do it.
What advice do you give young people who are coming out of school and entering the business world and wanting to rise to the top?
Yeah, it's hard, because of course my own children kind of fall into that category at this point. I'm not sure how qualified you are to give your own children any advice, but I think I have been it took a long time, but I've been very fortunate, certainly in the last 15 20 years, to have intertwined something I'm crazy passionate about in my own personal life with something with my professional career. So this sort of development of this thread of education, my motto is I'm the most boring person at a party, because there's only one thing I can talk about, but to be able to actually wrap your professional career in something, in a passion, is just something that you really are. It's just the greatest thing that could possibly happen. And it didn't happen overnight, and I certainly did spend many years not satisfied with that alignment. And I'm just incredibly fortunate that it aligned. So I think that the advice I give is, as I said, to my own kids, or to actually many of the angel investments that I have are run by young entrepreneurs who, in at least one case was just, had just graduated from Yale. And in other cases, are not that far out of college. Is that if you can align, if you can align your passion with what you're doing professionally, that is just a recipe for, certainly, I don't know if you're going to get to the top, but it's a recipe for great satisfaction. I think the other dynamics will flow through. I think the other advice, becomes very specific. It's hard to, I spend most of my time around entrepreneurs, and that's a hard thing. It takes a lot of scrappiness, and it's not always perfect, and aren't always able to raise money, and sometimes they go out of business, and that's actually not such an infrequent occurrence, and that is a deeply stressful thing. I mean, when we were doing our own businesses, particularly with Think Equity, that was an incredibly stressful realization that you had a lot of people counting on you, and so I try to encourage people to realize that to have some self-awareness of how stressful it is, and to, you know, obviously maintain humor to the best of your ability, and to stay focused. And again, I do kind of come back, if you can align, you know, mission and passion with what you're doing, it certainly makes it all a lot more satisfying.
Deborah, what do you think makes a great leader?
Oh, you know, I think a great leader is someone who can, you know, certainly someone who can pull, who can get people in line behind them, or with them, actually, beside them, both behind and beside, and, you know, below and above and everything else. I think great leaders, you know, command, and they don't do it by forcing, and they do it by, you know, providing their own example to other people, and they do it by making people want to work with them, and whether that's, you know, in the dynamics in the companies I deal with, you know, they have a lot of dynamics. They've got very, you know, investors in early stage companies are very active. It's real different than, you know, investors in a public company or something. You've got investors that are at your board table who are demanding results. And so early stage companies have demands from lots of constituents, investors, employees, the client that they're trying to serve with their product. Et cetera. So I think that the great leaders sort of maintain their cool, and they maintain their humor, and they are able to galvanize people around them, and then convey their vision. I think being able to convey your vision is a really important thing, and to not sweat under stress is a very hard thing to do. We see it all the time where, you know, people that look like they were incredibly well equipped to be a CEO of a startup or of an early stage company based on resume just simply weren't, because they didn't have the risk taking profile, they didn't have the ability to remain unemotional, or the ability to kind of stay on vision as long as that vision, you know, seems to be tracking. So I think it is, you know, just a lot of fortitude and humility, and I come back to humor, but humor and humility seem to be, you know, often are hand in hand, and the ability to press forward and to bring people along with you, because it's a pretty critical component, at least with the organizations that, you know, that I kind of deal with day in and day out.
Do you do anything differently during a crisis as a leader?
It's just interesting to see the I'm not sure that they're doing things differently per se, but it's interesting to see a company that's under, you know, a year ago was under deep duress and potentially the vision wasn't working for whatever reason, and it was the wrong product market alignment, or it was the wrong approach to market. And it's been fascinating to watch. And I can, in my head, I've got a couple, you know, two CEOs I'm thinking about who both maintained their cool in a situation where it could have been a complete meltdown. They could have, you know, had to, you know, their investors could have had them close the doors. But instead, they pressed forward, didn't lose their cool with any of the constituents, and actually had the patience and the wherewithal to actually recycle the vision. So take the vision. And in actually both cases, it was not that the idea was off. It was the idea was off in the market that it was being addressed at. And so in both cases, they readdressed market, modified the product accordingly, and are seeing actually incredible momentum and success today. Those CEOs aren't different today than they were a year ago, but you know, they certainly are a lot happier today than they were a year ago. There's no question about that. But I do just incredibly admire, they couldn't operate with the kind of confidence that they can today. And that, you know, and when you're less confident, you are a little bit of a different human when you feel less confident about what you're doing. So their own anxiety about where they sat didn't cause them to overreact and to put the business at even, you know, more risk. So, you know, I do think for when you're in a crisis, you just really have to, you know, do the best you can to put on blinders and to operate in a box and to really think hard and to take good counsel from, hopefully you've got good mentors and good, because I do think, you know, back to your earlier point, there's nothing more important than good mentors, whether that's an investor or whether that's a, you know, a business partner or whatever. The mentor thing is and I think is one of the most important, you know, sort of trends across, you know, frankly, across learning. I think there's just a whole mentoring component to learning, period. But yeah, and I think keeping your head down in a crisis, you know, taking advice from people, getting counsel, finding mentors you trust and can align with, is kind of what you need to do in a crisis. And try not, you know, and try to maintain the candor on the one hand, because I think I've also seen through actually one of my children where they were in a situation where the reaction of the management was to not have transparency. It was actually to try to make it, you know, really the opposite. And that exacerbated all kinds of anxiety. So I think it's difficult in a crisis to be transparent, but I think actually, ironically, you have a bigger need to be transparent in a crisis than you would typically. I think you always ought to be transparent, but it's important not to have the reaction that I'm just going to hide everything from everybody, because the reality is if you're hiding something from everybody, the odds are they're going to figure it out and it's going to make everybody worse, more anxious and probably get their resumes out the door as fast as they can. So I think transparency, you know, maintaining an ethos of transparency is another critical thing when you're in a crisis.
What is the knowledge economy?
Yeah, the knowledge economy really is sort of the migration of our economy from a manufacturing, farming, you know, a physical factory-based economy where, you know, all the goods and services were really measured by physical output into the increasing value being placed on intellectual property. And the contributions that many workers are making today are through their intellects. I think it's something that's been focused on for, you know, quite a bit, but I think it's gotten increasingly important. If you look at it today, if we look forward on jobs, we have 30% of the U.S. population has a college degree, and if you actually look at the jobs that are available, you know, the alignment with most jobs, about 80% of, you know, good employable careers require a college degree. So we've got this massive mismatch in knowledge. And I think what we see is some of the incredible stresses in our culture, undoubtedly being created by our failure to provide equal access to to everyone in the population, to a great education. So, because of course that's what builds up, you know, the knowledge that results in the knowledge economy. So that's really become a very, you know, critical focus for us at GSV and both on a commercially, but, you know, importantly as a mission. So
why did you name your company Global Silicon Valley? What's the significance of that?
Yeah, and I will give credit for that to my partner Michael Moe, who's in Silicon Valley and has been, you know, living and working, you know, out of there for over 20 years. I think the thesis is that, you know, certainly in the day, you know, the only place you could go for the development of, you know, new ideas and new thinking and, you know, building incredible IP and new companies, you know, Silicon Valley has been the heartbeat of the world, really, not just America, but the world in terms of innovation. And the idea with Global Silicon Valley is that Silicon Valley is really at this point an ethos and a concept, and that it is not confined to geographic limitations. So as we look at, I won't be able to do his ditty, but it's something like from Mumbai to Shanghai to Dubai, to Boston to Austin. But if you do look around the world and you see what's happening from an innovation perspective in Austin, in Salt Lake City, in Boston, in New York, which has been just extraordinary story, that we really are seeing a global ethos around the innovation and the excitement and the brilliant ideas that have come out of Silicon Valley. And Silicon Valley still maintains an awfully strong share, but there are others both domestically and globally who are certainly replicating the high success model that's existed for such a long time in Silicon Valley. So that was the idea. It's a state of mind, not a geographic definition.
What's the mission of GSV? How is it unique?
Yeah, I think GSV, it's a larger entity than just our team is doing here in Chicago, which is really focused on the education portion. But the bigger vision on GSV is really, my partner likes to say, focusing on the stars of tomorrow today. So what we're trying to do is identify emerging trends and themes in the growth economy, companies that are going to become the next leader in a sector, the next leader in big data, the next Google, the next Starbucks, et cetera. And so our mission really has been to align ourselves and we're specifically within education, technology, and education innovation, aligning ourselves with innovators who are trying to, you know, change the world. What we like to say, innovators who are focused on delivering a high return on education. And return on education for us means that an organization that is focused on increasing access and improving learning outcomes for learners of all sorts, from pre-K to gray, which is the sort of continuum we like to look at. Because, you know, our view being that improved learning outcomes is sort of the one way that we can ensure that, you know, every citizen here and every citizen in the world has access to the future economy. And so that's really our mission is to focus on and support. So we've created a number of things that support the entrepreneurial ecosystem in education. We do a big event in partnership with Arizona State University in April every year that really celebrates education innovation, and a number of other things like that that you know we view as sort of our mission to try to support across the entrepreneurial ecosystem in education innovation.
What did it take to start GSV? What were some of the key decisions and pivotal moments?
I think what it took to start GSV was it was actually a pretty natural. I think probably the harder move was starting Think Equity, because that was really the first time I had stepped out of a big company to start a new business. And and GSV is really involved starting two companies. One is GSV on my end of it, GSV Advisors, which is the which I've already described, and then the GSV, ASU GSV Summit, which is really a separate entity, but very complementary and part of our platform. So I think for me, it was such a natural evolution of having started Think Equity, built it to a couple hundred people, offices all over the U.S., sold it to a U.K. company, been on the board there for a bit, and then deciding that it was really, you know, we'd sold our company, so we didn't own it anymore, and so it was time to move on. It was the GSV move was much more of a natural evolution from having done the prior business, and it was aligning. You know, it was really aligning the things that I wanted to be doing, which was I wanted to have time at this point in my life to be, you know, to spend, you know, up to a half of my time doing philanthropic and civic work in education. So I'd really, you know, I'd never until then been able to do that. We, you know, I had three wonderful children who are now adults, basically, and I had a job, and I had never really been able to allocate my time in that way. So I think that the big thing for me with GSV was being able to sort of say, you know, this is what we're going to be known for. We're going to take our footprint in education innovation, make it, you know, the cornerstone of everything that I do, and then build, you know, properties around it, like the summit and my angel investing and the activity that my partner Michael does out of Silicon Valley, and so, you know, I'd love to tell you that it was really, really hard. Think Equity was really hard, GSV was really a I hate to call it a labor of love, but it was a labor of love, and was really, to me, kind of the next very natural step. And then I began to build, you know, a small team, and I've got just an amazing group of folks here working with me, and that's been fabulous. And I've got at least one person who's been working with me, you know, almost 20 years, I think, here. So So we've got some really nice continuity, so it's been a pretty joyful, experience in terms of building this part of this leg of my career.
You talk about the importance of your partners. Who are some of your partners in your mission, and how do you work with them?
Yeah, well, I've been working with Michael Moe for 18 years actually. He's based in Silicon Valley in Woodside. He's the co-founder of GSV Advisors and the GSV entity. And we've been working around education. Michael and I have many great partners. Obviously, I've got my team here. He's got a great team in Woodside. But Arizona State is a great example of a partner of ours that has been just incredible. We were fortunate, and it's better sometimes to be lucky than good. Michael joined a committee at Arizona. Neither one of us had any natural affiliation with ASU. About seven, eight years ago, he joined an innovation committee at ASU. Michael Crow, who's the president of ASU at the time and still is, who had come from Columbia to take over the ASU, was on that committee, and they began working, began talking and about what kind of things we could do in partnership. That was the birth of the ASU GSV Summit, which started with 400 people in a small facility at ASU's Skysong Economic Hub. This year we had 2,500 people attend at the Phoenician. So it really has been something that's resonated. So ASU has just been an incredible partner, and they've been they are themselves such a thought leader in the higher education space, and frankly in the lifelong learning space. And every year what they're doing there gets richer, and we benefit from being able to talk with them and interact with them and discuss sort of innovation that they're driving, and I hope that's true in the opposite direction. So they've been an amazing partner. We have others, and that's the beauty of the education space, and actually the summit we do with ASU is what we love about it, and I think what we're most proud about is that we are able to draw together what we like to call a strange cocktail of people. So it's not just an investor conference. There are investors there, but there are 300 entrepreneurial companies there, and then there are all the major foundations who care passionately about transforming educational outcomes for all. There are corporations, there are importantly educators, both from the K-12 side as well as the higher ed side, as well as the lifelong learning side. So what we do, we try to do is draw different sets of people together, and I think that is also reflected in our partners. We've actually, the Gates Foundation is another great example. They've been a terrific partner of ours. We've worked with them on a research basis, as they've kind of evaluated how they make an impact from a philanthropic investor perspective. We've been very fortunate to have them ask us to help them a couple of times in that regard, with some thought, some of their thought leadership. And then they've been a great partner for us on our summit, where they help us bring finance. This last year, the Gates Foundation and the Walton Foundation helped us bring 150 of the most innovative principals and superintendents from all across the country to convene at this event. So we've got some really incredible partners in those kinds of people. And I think the nice thing about education that we can keep going, we've got great partners on the investor side. There's think of a guy, Ryan Craig, who runs a group called University Ventures, who's been a terrific partner of ours, focuses on the higher ed market. Michael Horn, who's been Clay Christensen's partner, doing much of the writing around, transformation to blended learning, both in K-12 and in college, has been a great partner. So, we go on and on and on. I think that you're very blessed within this space, that there are so many people who care passionately about making an impact, and I think there's a real kind of brotherhood or sisterhood or whatever it is around people locking arms and trying to work together collaboratively to make a difference. So I could go on, I think, for hours on the partnership side, but we've been really, really fortunate to have great ones.
So how can leaders encourage innovation in the education space? How do you encourage innovation in that space? What do you see happening?
I think I think different people are doing, have done different things to catalyze innovation. I think I think one thing that just had to happen, which happened very slowly in education compared to other sectors of the economy, education just lagged in terms of having digital natives driving things. It lagged in terms of connectivity in schools, and so that was, just incredible impediment. It lagged in terms of just a reticence which still exists, of course, but a reticence to think about new models. I think that's changing rapidly, however. So I think that what leaders, you know, you need to stay focused on the end goal. And the end goal, you know, I mean, we can all get distracted by all kinds of political issues or all kinds of, you know, but the end goal is to drive improved learning outcomes so that everybody has access to the future. And so, you know, it's not, you know, a political debate about charter schools or a political debate about, you know, higher ed accreditation. It really is about how do we move the ball forward to get everyone benefiting. And I think you've seen incredible leadership from different, you know, types of entrepreneurs actually first just focused on some of these really big impediments, like, you know, how do we get schools more connected. You know, universities were always pretty good. K-12 was pretty bad. I think there have been some great initiatives out of the Obama administration has led the Connect Ed initiatives, and there have been some great leaders from the corporate space actually partnered with them on that to help advance the ball, you know, both the corporate and the philanthropic space. So I think that there has been, in education, you needed leadership first to take the ball into some of the fundamental problems. To try to get some of the impediments moved so natural entrepreneurs could come in and actually have successful offerings. Because you couldn't have a successful digital offering, which people tried in 1999, 2000, if you took you know, a computer into a classroom and there was no Wi-Fi. So it was going to be really difficult for you know, for anything like that to work until some of these basic things got, you know, fixed. And while they're not all fixed, some really good things have happened there. I think it's really interesting. I mean, I think people like, you actually look at somebody like Wendy Kopp and Teach for America, I think the impact that she's had on the education sector is extraordinary. And it's not just because you're putting incredibly talented young people into schools that need, you know, talented teaching support to augment the existing talented teaching support, but what she did was make, you know, education cool, right, to a group of people who really it was not occurring to university graduates that, you know, who were majoring in computer sciences, that they should think about taking a couple of years off and actually teach and develop an understanding of the dynamics that are happening in classrooms, particularly low-income classrooms all over the country. And so the impact she's had, while it's been pragmatic on a, you know, impact children level, I think the impact she's had on the thinking of generations and the importance of teaching, and that it is something that the CS major at, you know, MIT ought to be thinking about doing, even if for an interim period. So we've seen, as a result of groups like that, this outpouring of talent into both into schools, but also into entrepreneurial endeavors. So if you can actually look at a lot of education technology companies the talent that is poured into the ed tech sector, which really had not existed. I certainly don't just credit to Teach for America, but it has been, you know, I think there's just been an incredibly heightened awareness of the importance of addressing our fundamental issues. And I think the talent level that we're seeing, you know, really across the space from K-12 to higher ed to lifelong learning is something we've never seen before. So I think it's made all the difference. And I think it's when you have leaders like the Wendy Kopps of the world who kind of create this paradigm that completely changes the way people think about a sector, it has this ripple effect that, you know, of unintended consequences on the positive side that that are hard to, you know, hard to imagine.
I keep hearing you say, and I can tell that you really care about making the future accessible to everyone. And I would love to hear a little more about your thoughts on that in America, especially since in so many states, you know, schools are tied to property taxes, etc. What do you see happening? Do you think it's possible? Well, I think it's possible.
We certainly, Illinois is one of the more complex, and Chicago is one of the more complex financial situations out there today. So I get that in, deeply. That having been said, I think across the country, and, you know, there's been a lot of research work done on this, our issue does not appear to be money. Because if you actually compare the money spent in schools in the U.S. And that's not going to be categorically true, because there's a very, you know, large differences between how much a child in Chicago is being allocated and how much a child in Newark is being allocated. And the difference in that case is about $13,000, which is extraordinary. But it is, so we have these strange state-by-state inequities. But at the end of the day, I'm sure there's someone, but I think that there's not a consensus that the problem is money across the country. So I think there are many efforts afoot that I think are going to make good things happen. And I think I certainly don't believe education technology is a silver bullet. Education technology is only helpful in the hands of great educators. So, and by the way, you know, in the adult market, those great educators could be yourself, right? I mean, because, you know, the ability to go on Coursera and take a great course from the computer science professor at Harvard, you know, that you couldn't have gotten to otherwise, and, you know, that's just a remarkable thing that we can all do now that we couldn't do 5 years ago, certainly not 10 years ago. So I think the role for education technology is to give leverage to great educators. So, and again, whether that great educator is you or whether the great educator is a terrific teacher in a K-12 classroom. And I think that what you see, the potential for it, and I don't think we by any, you know, any stretch achieve the potential yet, but the potential is to allow a teacher to stand in front of a classroom, particularly I'm very focused on, you know, low-income urban classrooms, where children can be in a single class with a very divergent set of, you know, fourth grade class can have children, you know, reading at first grade level and reading at eighth grade level. And for a teacher to be able to address that in a broadcast model is just, you know, outside of a miracle, very, very difficult. So I think the potential for education technology is around personalization, and that's personalization in a classroom like that. It's personalization, you know, if you're doing online learning in, you know, on your own or in cohort groups, to create peer learning. So I think that there's a huge need to create personalization. There's a huge need to create scaled mentoring. I mean, kind of back to the whole mentoring point, there are really interesting things happening around organization. It's both organizations, it's both not-for-profits and for-profits creating scaffolding and support systems online for, you know, university students who are showing signs of, you know, that they may drop out, and the ability to use data and the ability to use online sort of online virtual models to create supports and peer supports and academic supports as scaffolding when you see somebody is at risk or when you know someone's potentially at risk going in is just a sea change from where we were, because, you know, doing it in a model that only involves, you know, live humans support, not that, which is a great model, but is a tough model to scale, you know, in across millions and millions and millions of people. So I think we're seeing some really exciting things happen around individualized learning that's going to help students both catch up or advance, you know, in their own way. You know, there's lots going on around, you know, sort of blended classrooms that are not, you know, sort of these very limited physical, you know, you're in first grade, second grade, third grade. I mean, there's these sort of lockstep patterns, but letting children move at their own pace and then allowing us to get children to catch up where, you know, and remediated where needed. So I think that there is some really exciting things happening. We have a really, really long way to go, but I do think that there are some very good trend lines around focusing on data. I mean, Chicago actually is a great example. We had the University of Chicago develop something called, it's really a big data analysis, the freshman on track analysis, and it measures a number of things for freshmen freshmen in high school, in all of our high schools, and it can tell, you know, whether it's truancy or whether it's they're late or whether it's not, on a whole bunch of measures they can tell whether a freshman is moving off track. And what they had figured out through, again, data analysis was that students moving off track freshman year have a incredibly high correlation of dropping out by the time, you know, before they hit senior year. And so that freshman on track rate in Chicago, I'm not going to have the numbers sitting in front of me, but since U of C began working with Chicago Public Schools and tracking that and intermediating to help those students that are off track, our graduation rates have gone straight up. Our freshman, freshman on track has gone straight up. Graduation rates as a result have gone straight up. And test scores, while still not adequate, have moved up. So, and college going rates have moved up. So, it's just interesting what you can do when you really focus on the problem and you use data and then personalization to try to go in and remediate, you know, at the student level. So that's what I'm optimistic about.
Do you think that we're teaching the right skills, leadership and otherwise, in American universities? What skill gaps are you concerned about?
Yeah, I don't know if it's universities. I think we do. And I think there's a lot of really exciting stuff going on there. I think the whole move to complement, Southern New Hampshire University, has become a real, along with Western Governors, which actually has been doing it the longest time. There's really exciting activity around competency-based learning. So, which is really focused on, skills you've acquired, moving away from sort of, seat time requirements at the university level, and moving towards, you want to achieve the following competencies by the time you graduate, and those competencies are going to translate into X, Y, or Z job because they actually align with the skills those jobs are going to require. I think that, I think that's an incredibly important development that we are, and the Department of Education, Arne Duncan and team have been hugely supportive in working with the sort of front-leaning universities who are doing this. It's not going to be a solution for everybody, but it's a great complement to what, we have a great system of elite universities, which is fine. And then we've got to move this 30% university graduate level up to some form of better align it with what the jobs are requiring, the 80%. And so I think some of the activity around driving competency-based learning and aligning skills is extremely optimistic, and as I said, I think has gotten great support from the Department of Education and others, and so I think it'd be hard to categorically say our university's not teaching the right things. I think I'm sure some universities are not teaching the right things, but I do think that universities are. I mean, we see it at Arizona State. I mean, it's remarkable what they've done in terms of focusing in their largest public university in the country, the programs they have developed around using a blended model and an online model to focus on remediation. So freshmen, students come in who aren't ready, they typically drop out, and because they take remedial courses, they're so boring that they figure they're never going to make it and it's a waste of time and they don't get credit for it anyway, so they just drop out. So it's caused dropout, it's a pervasive problem across the university system. And ASU is one of the first to really tackle it using adaptive online programs that were fun and engaging, and they got the students involved. And so the students didn't think it was this drudgery that they had to do, and therefore they ought to drop out. It's had a huge impact on the retention rates for freshmen at ASU, which then, of course, filters through to the students who are going to graduate. So that's all about filling skills gaps that, frankly, wasn't really the university's fault originally, because if a student's coming into a university lacking the skills that they probably should have gotten in high school, that actually didn't used to be the issue, the university's issue. Well, I think a lot of, most universities have now woken up to realize they've got to remediate, students who were not properly prepared coming out of high school, because otherwise they're going to drop out and we're just going to exacerbate the problem. So there have been some really, I think there's some really good activity around skills training and competency training, skills, it's hard to use the right words, but at the university level and making sure that our students are actually getting something for the 2 to 4 to 6 years that they're putting into it and coming out with something that's going to allow them to get a job.
How is technology changing the way that people learn?
It sort of has moved from this early education technology was basically taking a book and putting it online, and so you were just reading the same book you were just reading. It was like having, doing the Kindle. I think that what it is changing, one, you're seeing a whole bunch of activity around smaller pieces. So, as you've been talking to a company today, and you and I were talking about it earlier too, just what technology is allowing related to engagement, actually, to kind of take learning and put it into more bite-sized pieces, which are going to actually stick with you intellectually longer, challenge you more. I think it's added a whole social element to, you know, to the right versions of technology can allow students to collaborate and to work in peer groups and to work across, you know, geographies. And so I think that what technology is doing, and to do it just in time. I mean, the fact that I can get in the back of a cab and go onto my Duolingo app and practice Spanish is kind of cool. I mean, I think the ability to kind of be a just-in-time learner around very specific topics, is just a sea change. I mean, what Lynda.com did in terms of being able to learn, various things around online technologies and website development and marketing, online marketing and things like that. Again, it just has been a real change in the ability of really everybody, but certainly it's a sea change for adults, because now we can all go on and in any moment of free time that we have, learn something that's useful for our job or learn something that's just going to add to our intellectual store. So I think that online, and I think we're just at the beginning. I think there's going to be, just a wave of, I mean, gamification has sort of been at the edges of learning for a while. I think it's going to move much more into the mainstream. I think you're seeing all kinds of research around really well-designed games can truly be learning. I mean, there's been a real fear, I think, justifiably so, that, this can't be about games. It's got to be a learning. And how do you actually make a game learning? And I think we're getting closer and closer to a place where gamification is absolutely legitimate learning. It can have incredibly powerful impacts. I was just looking at a YouTube or a TED Talk video, a TEDx Talk video on from a professor at UC SF, around the positive impact that really well-designed games can have on ADHD children and causing them to really develop much far better executive function and focus. And so I think we're about to see really interesting things happen in that area and in the whole realm of brain plasticity and the ability for neuroscience to actually, for learning to really kind of take on some healthcare elements. And it's been something that's been sitting there at the fringes and has, because it just wasn't ready yet for a couple of decades, actually. But I think we're sort of right at the we're going to see virtual reality can become a huge factor in online learning. We're just at the front edge of innovation there. But I think it's everything from the ability to use it in medical school simulations of real surgeries to the ability to let, children work in a virtual reality environment where they can actually react to real situations that can replicate real life and develop better skills that way. I think we're really at the front end of how technology can really change learning. I think we're sort of maybe in the first inning of that real, the real true impact of it.
So is this the new paradigm that you see emerging? What do you envision this looking like in the future?
Well, I think that what it's going to look like is, and I think it will, I'm not sure I love the term blended learning because I feel like it's a, kitchen machine.
And what is blended learning?
Blended learning is the concept where you're simply blending the use of technology in a live learning setting. So you may do some, it's kind of, Khan Academy had one version of blended learning, which you would, the flipped classroom where you would, use Khan Academy at home at night, you'd watch videos and then you come in, having prepared those, and then you can come in and talk in class, which is sort of making it a Socratic live session and more, the broadcast learning happening at home. There are various forms of blended, but generally speaking, it's using both the digital and live learning techniques. So I think the new paradigm, I think, is, for one, definitely blended. So I think we're going to see, the integration of technology with live learning, with live peer groups, with live project sessions, et cetera, happening at a much higher, a very pervasive pace over time. So I think that, is a simple paradigm. I do think that the in the long run, people are going, if you look at the data on, the expectation for the millennial generation in terms of number of jobs, it's something the expectation is between 15 and 18 jobs in their lifetimes, and, which is stunning. I mean, I think I've had, how many jobs have I had? Three, maybe, four. And that the expectation that there, that job change velocity, and oh, by the way, the fact that their jobs, even without moving companies, are changing at an incredible velocity, unimaginable 5 or 10 years ago, is that this whole lifelong learning requirement really, I mean, is going to really become a requirement. So it is, in order to stay up, in order to get the next job, in order to stay competitive in your existing job, or just frankly just to be intellectually stimulated. So I think I feel the peer pressure. I love the move that code.org and Hadi Partovi, who started that, who's a genius entrepreneur. I love that coding has moved mainline, and it really happened remarkably quickly. I mean, it was a couple of activities like that, and some companies. I'm an investor in a company called Tinker, which is wonderful, and that teaches coding logic to fourth grade up through middle school. So there was just a wonderful velocity of activity around coding that moved it mainline. Just an incredible pace. I mean, 3 years ago, it was unheard, and now you can't go anywhere without hearing about a coding academy, and which is great. So it's really become just a natural language for everybody to talk about, and not this big thing that everybody was afraid of. So I think that's the kind of thing that can happen in the learning world, where we're beginning to embed some natural things that should become part of our vocabulary into learning, whether it's online or whether it's offline. So I think the new paradigm is you're just going to feel, both competitively and for wanting to, be in the game yourself, a need to continually learn. And the easiest way to do that is going to be online. I mean, in the long run. I mean, I think for adults who are time constrained. And so, and resource constrained, and both from a time and money standpoint. So, I think that's the new paradigm. I think it'll be very blended in K-12, and I think you'll see, it'll be blended in higher ed, but you'll see more and more higher ed that can be done, primarily online, and I think everybody will get very, personally, I think people will get increasingly comfortable with that.
Who are a couple of the influential, notable entrepreneurs or companies who are having the most impact on the knowledge economy?
Yeah, well, I already mentioned on the social side, Wendy Kopp, who is a total hero. I do think on the company side, I think Saul Khan, again, obviously it's a not-for-profit, but so it's not a commercial enterprise, but, gosh, what he's done in terms of, frankly, it feels like this is ancient history, but just what he was able to do in terms of making educators comfortable going online to find resources that might back them up, not to mention to give students additional resources to support themselves. I think he really broke a wall that had been built a long time ago and gave incredible access to some really great resources. I don't know. I mean, I love doing his lessons. So I think he's just a real hero around that. I already talked about code.org, but I think Hadi Partovi and code.org has been great. I think Linda Weinman and her husband Bruce, who founded Lynda.com in their garage or whatever many years ago, and quietly built the company with no outside capital this absolute powerhouse of an online learning delivery platform, obviously selling to LinkedIn a month or two ago for a very large an impressive value. She and Bruce have been models for so many in the industry, including me. And it was great to see two wonderful, humble, passionate people around mission build a great business that actually scaled. Because many of us have sort of lived through long periods where there was just enormous skepticism around the ability to scale companies in the education markets, but I think Coursera, is a remarkable company founded by two Stanford professors, Daphne Koller and Andrew Ng, and then now run by the former president of Yale, Rick Levin. He's got an incredible team, 13 million learners on their system. Their early growth was faster than the growth of Facebook. In terms of users. And so I think there's some revolutionary things, you know, and I personally, there's a lot of back and forth on the MOOC market. I think the MOOCs are very much in the early innings. I think there is going to be a lot of success coming out of those models, you know, over the long run. And it was just such a radical thing when it came out of the box. But again, both what Coursera and edX, which is a not-for-profit, you know, the not-for-profit version, is, although requires, you know, substantial philanthropic funding, both of those guys broke so many barriers. You know, it basically, when those two launched and were able to announce so many university partners so quickly, it effectively eliminated the barrier to any discussion of online learning at the higher education level. So it really was no longer a question of walking in and saying, well, will you ever do online learning? It now has become, would I do it here? Would I do it here? Will I do it myself? Will I do it in partnership with a company like 2U, which has been a great success as a public company, who works with premier universities like USC and Chapel Hill and others. So, you know, I think that there are a lot of people creating incredible footprints. And I sort of said it earlier, but I think a lot of credit has to go to the people who have been working to eliminate impediments. And I do think there's been a lot of great work out of the Department of Education. Dear friend of ours, Jim Shelton, worked on a lot of the innovation grants, and I think a lot of the grants that the DOE used to give strong incentives to states and districts and others to think about innovation had incredibly powerful impacts. So, I think it's been an embarrassment of riches from a sector that had really not historically seen that. So it's been really a great 5-7 year period here in the innovation markets for education.
And for our viewers, a MOOC is basically online classes.
So a MOOC is free, and it is online, and it's open, meaning it's free. And what the MOOCs, Coursera, edX is a partnership, really came out of MIT in a partnership with Harvard, and they have both Harvard and MIT professors doing online courses. But they've also partnered with many other universities, including a recent partnership announced with Arizona State. They also partner with UT and others. Coursera similarly has partnered. As I said, two Stanford professors, run now by Rick Levin, former president of Yale, and they have partnered with hundreds of universities. I should know the partner number off the top of my head, but globally, as has edX, from Princeton to in Michigan to Illinois to you name it, doing some really really innovative work around delivering free courses. You can then pay if you complete the courses. You can then pay to be certain to receive a certificate for the work that you've done in the courses, and that's become a really really important factor in terms of being able to then take your certification, because people can then take their certification and use it in their place of employment or use it in their looking for a place of employment to verify the fact that they took a course and they passed the testing requirements and that sort of thing. So it's become a really interesting disintermediation of that market because the courses themselves are being taught by very prominent people from very prominent organizations, and they're free. So
with the 2016 election cycle and the primaries already heating up, I'm curious, what would you like to hear from candidates about education?
Yeah, I think it's deeply, deeply disappointing that education is just rarely the top issue. And I think sometimes that's because, and perhaps this was the last cycle, sometimes it's because there's too much agreement. So it's not a topic that they're willing to talk about because they don't disagree enough to actually generate press. And that's frustrating, but we would certainly, of the guys and gal, one gal, who are out there, so far, the one, Jeb Bush is the one person who has really staked a very firm claim on education as an issue. He's got, you know, certainly Chris Christie and others, and Hillary Clinton has begun, particularly in the early childhood space, she's put a big stake there. So I would really like to see some very active discussion around the importance of solving this problem, the importance of us being the flexibilities being adopted, and the importance of focusing on the end goal, which is better outcomes for learners as opposed to any of the other noise around it. And how we get there should be all about great teaching and great outcomes. The good news is, I think despite the lack of conversation, I think the current administration has certainly made, I think, very strong progress on the K-12 side. I think the higher ed side has had quite a bit of controversy, but we'll see how that continues to play out. I think there's some interesting stuff going on a bipartisan basis right now in Congress. And I guess one of the other reasons that they don't, there's not as much conversation is because, of course, education has been viewed to be a state's, is viewed to be a state issue, more of a state's issue, which is part of the issue we have today with the Common Core being perceived as something that's been, jammed down by a national, where it was really created by the Conference of Governors. But I would like to see it front and center. I would like to see everybody take a very aggressive stance on the importance of us resolving some of these critical issues, particularly for low-income students who are not going to participate in our democracy if we can't get them equal access to a great education. And it's criminal that we do anything that doesn't support that outcome.
Thanks so much.
Absolutely. It's delightful to be with you.
I'm Jennifer Crumpton. Thanks so much for stopping by and joining us today on Sardar TV. We'll see you next time.